Robby Mook, Kellyanne Conway, thank you so much for being here. Really appreciate it. So, we're going to walk through a lot of key moments of the campaign, but before we do, Robby, I know there are a lot of people here, especially here at Harvard, who are wondering, what happened? What went wrong? Obviously, Hillary Clinton won the popular vote, and she won more votes for president than any white man in history, but this is obviously a race to 270, and she came up short in traditionally Democratic states like Michigan, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin. She told donors not long after the election that she thought the letter from FBI Director James Comey was really the nail in the coffin for her. Do you agree? Is that what went wrong?
Well, look, we are really proud of her margin in the popular vote. But as you said, this was about electoral college votes, and we did come up short. We felt very good about where we were going into the last 10, 20 days of the election. I think it is hard to imagine the kind of impact that that letter had. Most of the public polling showed a distinct drop. We certainly saw that in our internal numbers, and particularly because the letter didn't really seem to have much of a purpose. He said he had some emails, he hadn't seen them, he didn't really know what they were. When you look across those three states that you mentioned that we lost, we're talking about 100,000 votes. Anything could have made a difference with such small margins, less than 1% in each of those states. But we do think that that was an incredibly powerful force in the race. You know, the other reality is, we were hoping for stronger performance in some sectors, and a lot of the data was very off in this race. So we have to reflect on all of those reasons.
What sectors?
Well, we were expecting to perform better with suburban women in particular. We saw those numbers a lot stronger than what happened on Election Day. We do think that was because of the Comey letter. We saw a lot of young people go to third party candidates. We think the letter had a lot to do with that as well. So there were a number of reasons for this, but lead among them, in my view, would be that letter from Director Comey.
And Kellyanne, you said that the movement towards Donald Trump and away from Hillary Clinton among undecided voters and some of these key demographic groups started before the Comey letter came out.
Yes, and you even see the public polls that reflected what we were seeing internally, Jake. For example, ABC News released a poll on a Sunday that said 50-38. We really didn't believe that she was at 50. We knew we were not under 40. But everybody then had to live with that 12-point poll because people held it up as evidence that the race was over, that there was no way Hillary Clinton could lose, no way Donald Trump could win. And by Friday of that same week, it was a 1-point race. And that was before the Comey letter. Also, Secretary Clinton herself, the night of the day the Comey letter was released on October 28th, said at her rally that it didn't matter because Americans had already decided what they thought about the emails and that it was already baked in the cake. And this was a messaging point from her campaign. So at the time they said that, maybe it was wishful thinking, maybe they weren't being completely truthful. And now it's supposed to be the Comey letter. And I have to say, Donald Trump turned over 200 counties that went for President Obama in 2012 to Donald Trump in 2016. That's because of messages that connect with people in those areas, not because of a letter late in the game. I do think that it probably had an effect on some voters. But if you want to reach suburban women, and the question is, you're the first female president running for president, as a party nominee, then why is the message not really connected to them? I also don't understand the lack of an economic message that was attractive to a lot of these working class voters that Donald Trump ended up winning, that President Obama won twice, and President Bush won twice, and President Bill Clinton won twice. And so I think there were things that could have been done ahead of Jim Comey, and there are many reasons that the election result turned out the way it did, but I look at counties like Cambria County, Pennsylvania, where he won by almost 30 points. I look at counties like Mahoning County, Ohio, where even President Bush got about 36% there, as did Senator McCain and Governor Romney, President Obama 62%, and yet Hillary Clinton got about 49%, we got 46%. So even trying to close margins in places like that, that happens over a series of weeks and months of planning and messaging and deploying our best assets, Donald Trump and Mike Pence, to those areas repeatedly. even more than, say, one action by the FBI director.
I want to get to messaging in a little bit, but let's back up to June 2015. Donald Trump comes down the escalator at Trump Tower, announces that he's going to run for president. It seemed back in the primaries that many people in your campaign, Robby, wanted Donald Trump to be the nominee, that you thought he would be easier to beat than, say, Marco Rubio. Is that true, and why?
I think many Democrats did believe that. Certainly, you know, if you put out those candidates out at the beginning, I think most people would have said, yes, Donald Trump is certainly harder to beat. I think, obviously, our opinions on that changed as he progressed through the primary and was very successful by any standard in that primary. But look, all the way from the time that he sealed the nomination to, I think, our campaign released a video that I did, I don't know, maybe 10 days, 2 weeks out from the election, this was going to be close no matter what. It didn't matter who the Republican nominee is. These races are always very close. You know, we talk, again, this is an electoral college contest, but we talk about Hillary having a very high margin, actually the second highest ever in the popular vote. That's still, you know, only 2 million votes. These things are always very close. And so I think it was an error to ever underestimate what any Republican nominee could do. And I think one thing that Kellyanne and I would agree on, you know, she talked about how some of these public polls were inaccurate. I think every American should take away from this election that every vote matters everywhere, all the time. And we can never get complacent. And I would certainly hope that in upcoming elections that we take a little bit of the sport out of it and these projections and, you know, and just say, look, what matters is what happens on election day. Everybody has a right, but also a responsibility to turn out and cast that vote and make that choice very wisely.
And Kellyanne, you've been very critical of the polls, so let me give you an opportunity to weigh in on a rare moment of agreement here. Why were the polls so wrong?
I'm critical of the polls just because I own a place called The Polling Company, and I never want to practice law again, so I can't be that critical of the polls. But the polls are wrong for a couple of reasons. And when I say the polls, let's be very clear, these are mostly the public polls. So I think Joel Benenson's work, the internal polls, our polling work, we had 5 different polling firms working on, including my firm. Those don't really see the light of day. We're using those for internal strategic positioning. We're not trying to get clicks or make headlines or call the race over before it is one way or the other. I think a few things happened. One is presuming that the 2012 electorate would be the 2016 electorate. And that also presumed implicitly, Jake, that Secretary Clinton would be able to attract and knit together and indeed keep together what's called the Obama coalition. So a critical mass of voters of color, of millennials, and maybe even her running up the totals a little bit among women, since she's the first female candidate, and she was running a decidedly reach out to women as an anti-Trump message campaign to the very end. So I think that was a failing. The other failing is in presuming that people who had voted Democratic in the past would do so here, which is slightly different than the Obama coalition. We thought in our modeling that the 2016 electorate had a better chance of loosely resembling the 2014 electorate in some of these key states and counties, which was my obsession, the counties, than it would resemble the 2012 election. And so I talked very publicly, very early on, under a hail of criticism about the undercover Trump voter. And it was very real. And the undercover Trump voter, to put it all to rest, this is not somebody who's afraid to say they're voting for Donald Trump. That's not what it is. It's somebody who just doesn't look like a Trump voter. It's a union household that's voted Democratic for years. It's a single mom who couldn't possibly dream of voting for Donald Trump. Why would she do that when she can vote for Hillary Clinton, who's, quote, fighting for women and children? And so we just took an approach where we were a little bit more open-minded about who the electorate may be and allowed them to tell us who they were. I also think at some point there was just a conclusion in search of evidence. There's no way this country is going to vote for somebody who's an outsider, who has no political or military experience. We've never done it before. And I have to say, in that regard, I'm pretty proud of the country for at least making good on its self-avowed desire of decades to vote for someone who has no connection to Washington, will go there owing nobody anything, who is a true outsider, who perhaps can run the government like a business, who's not part of the quote, swamp to be drained. But in that regard, I think presuming that one knows what the electorate is really missed the zeitgeist of this year. And it also ignores it also ignores the phenomenon that was Bernie Sanders. A lot of those polls were wrong in the primaries as well. I mean, she was leading him by double digits in Michigan, and he won Michigan. So nobody really learned the lesson there either about maybe her vulnerabilities and maybe what the electorate would look like going forward.
Kellyanne, let me, go ahead.
One thing I'd add on to that. You know, I think, look, turnout wasn't what we wanted it to be in some places. And there were different stories across different states. You know, Philadelphia did turn out the way we would have liked, other states weren't. But one thing I think we did see across the country, I think Kellyanne would agree with this, was we did see record Hispanic turnout in a number of communities. I think that was important to our win in Nevada and Colorado. And that's why Texas, I think, was a lot closer than many people anticipated. Obviously, that wasn't enough for us to win the election. But I think that is something to be celebrated and lifted up. That was unprecedented. And, you know, I hope that those voters continue to turn out.
So, Kellyanne, you joined the Trump campaign as a pollster July 1st. People may not remember, but during the primaries, you were affiliated with a pro-Ted Cruz super PAC and actually opposed Donald Trump in some ways. But you came on board the Trump campaign July 1st. You were named campaign manager August 17th, the same day that Steve Bannon was named campaign CEO. It seemed as though, from the outside, you and Steve Bannon were able to convince Donald Trump to be more disciplined in a way that previous campaign managers had not convinced him to do, had not succeeded in getting through to him. Please stay on message, please stick with your teleprompter. Not that he only stuck with his teleprompter, but the kind of, one might call them self-inflicted wounds, you called them, your campaign calls them that with the Clinton campaign, but some of the gaffes, some of the more controversial statements he made, most of them took place disproportionately before you and Steve Bannon took over. And I'm wondering, what did you and Steve Bannon say to him to convince him, we will take over, but you really need to listen to us in terms of staying more on message?
First, Jake, let me publicly credit my predecessors, Corey Lewandowski and Paul Manafort, who had the position before I did, because they were instrumental in bringing Donald Trump to different, successfully bringing him to different stages of the campaign long before I got there. And I tell everyone this is a victory shared by all, which is, you know, it's a small team, but it's a team of people who others may not be aware of. And so I just want to give credit where credit is due and share it. But when we came on board, there were a couple of things. I said, I don't really divulge private conversations, but I feel confident in telling you that I said to Mr. Trump, you know, you're running against one of the most joyless presidential candidates in history, it seemed to me. So why don't we not be that way as a campaign? Why don't we find a way to be the happy warrior again? He loved doing the rallies. He loved connecting with people that way. So you have to know who your candidate is, and there is no substitute for a quality, compelling candidate, and work with his or her gifts. And I think in the case of Donald Trump, he gets his oxygen from being out there with the people, being with the voters. And so rallies were very important to, and he had done them, but in a general election strategy, there was a talk inside of not doing as many and giving a speech here or a speech there instead of big rallies. And so I think number one, it was playing to those strengths and those desires for him. But number two, I've known Donald Trump for a number of years, and he is a disciplined messenger. He's a successful businessman. He's brilliant. His instincts are excellent. And so knowing that, how do you take a guy who's fundamentally transactional and successful in nature and apply that to his presidential campaign? Having him go out there and give these four-point plans to reform the tax code, or a five-point plan to defeat radical Islamic terrorism, or a 10-point plan to reform the Veterans Administration. Then there were specifics. We saw in the polling data that one of the potential vulnerabilities was, well, what if he can't execute and deliver on what he's saying? Then he's just a typical politician who gets to Washington and can't deliver on his campaign promises. So it was imperative that he get out there in his own voice to the American people, cut through the noise or the silence, whatever the case may be, and deliver those specific solutions. Also, he, you know, in the case of Donald Trump, he loves polls, as you know, and it was good to have a pollster as a campaign manager, only because I was able to explain many things to him, but I'll quickly, briefly relate to. One is that we saw from the beginning something that really never changed, which is that Hillary Clinton had a 47% problem of her own. She just could never really get past 44, 46, 47% in these swing states that President Obama had carried twice with well over 50% of the vote. So we wanted to study very closely, why is that? Why can't she get that extra 6, 7, 10 points in a place like Michigan? President Obama carried Michigan by 10 points, we just won it. And so we studied that very carefully in the polls. And secondly, stop looking at the national polls. When I came on board, we never did another national poll. It sounded fascinating, great to do, but why would we do that? The race was about 12 or 14 states, and to go into those states and recognize that this train was running through the, it was a road to 270, and you had to get 270. I think before I got there, the idea, not necessarily among the two campaign managers, but an idea was, pervasive in the media too. She starts with this blue wall, which I agreed with. She starts with this blue wall of 239, 244 electoral votes. So we can either sit around and hope she doesn't get the next 26, or we can try to dip into her cache of 239 or 244. And that's what we tried to do. And I think strategically putting him in places where he hadn't been in the general election made the difference.
One thing I take issue with, I hear Kellyanne on, you know, us not breaking 46, 47% in some of these polls. I'm not a pollster, and so far be it for me to be the expert, but that's very typical, you know, when you're a non-incumbent in a number of these races. I think what did happen, and we discussed this early on, at the very end of the race, there were probably more undecideds than in a lot of races before. And we do think because the director of the FBI sent two letters in it, what was an unprecedented intervention in the election, total breach of protocol. Yes, I think a lot of those undecideds broke against us, but I don't think that was an inherent problem. And in fact, I would argue without those letters, we would have won those, and that's why we would have won the election. You know, the other thing I'd say, I mean, Kellyanne said it was a joyless campaign. I contest that. You know, we had a lot of fun campaign. I'm a joyful guy. Hillary's really joyful. We had a lot of fun on the campaign.
Did you struggle? Everybody who knows Hillary Clinton says that the person you see on stage is not the person that you see behind the scenes, that behind the scenes she's a much warmer person, a much more amusing person. Did you struggle to get that person from behind the scenes out into the crowd?
Look, there were a lot of headwinds in this race. You know, we were trying to make history. She's the first woman to be the nominee of a major party, but also the
why
Russian.
Why is that a headwind? Why is her being a woman a headwind?
Well, I think having worked for a few women candidates now, I think that they sometimes face certain scrutiny that male candidates don't. Sometimes people would talk about the way Hillary spoke during a speech. I didn't hear them remark about male candidates that way. But look, I think the bigger issue is that the Russian intelligence, our intelligence agencies all confirmed that Russian intelligence stole emails from our campaign chair and from the DNC and selectively leaked them out over months, starting at our Democratic convention, explicitly for the purpose of intervening in the election, hurting Hillary Clinton and helping Donald Trump. We faced these headwinds the whole way through. That was tough. And I think it absolutely affected the outcome. But I absolutely contest this was not a joyless campaign. And look, Hillary, you talk about Hillary working at the Children's Defense Fund. She has been an advocate for kids and families her whole life. And at the core of her desire to run in this race was to make life better for families, to fight for kids and families. That's what she's done her whole life, and that's what this campaign was about.
And Kellyanne, after you took over, Donald Trump recast or recalibrated two of his more controversial proposals, the ban on the total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering this country until we figure out what the hell is going on, I think is the exact quote. And a deportation force to round up the 11 to 12 million undocumented immigrants and remove them from the country. Those changed. He never explicitly repudiated them, but they changed in the way that he talked about them, the way that Governor Pence talked about them, the way that you talked about them. Was that part of the reset for the general election?
I think it's part of explaining what you meant by what you said and putting it in policy prescription type of language. And that's what he did. So for example, the same day, Jake, that Mr. Trump flew down to Mexico to meet with the Mexican president, he chose to accept the invitation. Secretary Clinton did not. He then flew to Arizona and gave, again, a 10-point plan on how to reform our immigration system. People may say they don't like it, but at least they can read it. They can examine it. He has one. It's there. He delivered it over about 45, 60 minutes. And then, of course, I'm sure it's on the website somewhere. So in that regard, he explained how he would approach the immigration system if he were to be elected. And people should go back and reflect upon that now, because it's very specific about building the wall and making sure these 2 or 3 million, it's estimated, we have no idea what the real number is, criminals who live here are gone immediately. And then he goes and talks about working with the different agencies and law enforcement to decide what to do with those that remain after the law is actually applied and enforced, which it currently is not. And then I did just want to, if I may, I said it was a joyless candidate, not a joyless campaign, because Robby knows I love and respect him. But however, I just want to say something, because I've spent a career as a female consultant, working on behalf of some female candidates, but as a Republican, often against female candidates in the Democratic Party. And the idea that the country was not ready for a woman completely undercuts the fact that maybe they weren't ready for this woman. And there's a difference. It wasn't generic, you know, do you want a woman, yes or no? It was, do you want Hillary Clinton?
Well, and I'm not saying that. I'm saying it's one of many.
I know you're not.
One of
many
headwinds we faced.
Let me ask you, Robby. Hillary Clinton's private email server first came to light in March 2nd, 2015, a big story in the New York Times. We learned from one of these hacked emails published by WikiLeaks that John Podesta, the campaign chairman, sent you an email saying, did you have any idea of the depth of the story? You answered, nope. We brought up the existence of emails in research this summer, but were told that everything was taken care of. In other emails, it comes out very clearly that there was a divide between the new guard, you and some others, and the old guard. And I'm wondering if you feel that some of the actions and activities that the old guard either allowed to happen, did themselves, or enabled, whether it is giving speeches to Goldman Sachs, or setting up the private email server, or the decision to become multi-millionaires, did the decisions by those individuals, the old guard, make your job close to impossible?
Well, no, not at all. We came very close to winning this campaign. And as I said, we won the popular vote. Look, Hillary said she regretted that email setup, that it was a mistake. She took responsibility for it, and she apologized.
No, I get it, but it happened, and it obviously, sure. You're talking about James Comey. James Comey is in this conversation because of the email server.
Sure, but I think, look, again, if any of us on the campaign could have gone back on a time machine, including Hillary Clinton, and changed this, absolutely, we would have. But I think despite that, this was the most overhyped, overreported, over-litigated story in the history of American politics. Full stop. It was. And particularly because of what James Comey did. You know, there are protocols at the Justice Department that they are not to intervene in electoral races. They're not to report out on investigations in, you know, 2, 3, 4 months before an election. This was a total breach of that protocol and totally unnecessary, particularly to write a letter saying we have some emails, I haven't even looked at them. It's mind-boggling why he did this.
Kellyanne, one of the things that came out that has come up in conversations after the election is that James Comey might not have felt empowered to do everything he did had the Attorney General Loretta Lynch not recused herself from decision making because Bill Clinton had that meeting with her on an airplane on a tarmac. Do you agree with that premise, that Bill Clinton in some ways empowered James Comey?
Yes, that is true. That actual meeting between the Attorney General and President Clinton bothered some voters because it just played right into the culture of corruption / the elite is in a different set of rules for them than for the rest of us. I mean, who in the world can do that? Walk across and go on and pretend you're talking about the grandchildren for, I don't know, 40, 45, 50 minutes. But I just want to say, too, lest Jim Comey be the scapegoat of this election, in fairness, Hillary Clinton had a very bad time convincing Americans, very tough time convincing Americans that she was honest and trustworthy. That was in everybody's polling, and that was long before the FBI investigation. She came into this campaign in June or July, I guess, of 2015, with, you know, pretty challenging numbers when it came to likability and veracity and trustworthiness. They got worse over time, but people knew her for many decades, and I felt she could have done more earlier to put that to rest, apart from the emails. And even the closing arguments tended not to be the usual aspirational, uplifting, visionary, positive type of arguments that successful presidential candidates make, such that you as a voter would say, you know, I don't like this whole FBI thing. I don't like the different set of rules for her and her emails or her husband getting on Loretta Lynch's plane or the fact that she used the State Department as a concierge for foreign governments to dump millions of dollars into
That's
it. I don't like that.
That's
but
not true. That's,
this is what the voters saw. I don't like that,
true.
But
that's
I'm
what Donald
vote
Trump
for her.
Said.
I'm going to vote for her. Well, that's what a lot of folks said.
You have taken an issue. Let me lead you to an issue that I think you want to talk about, which is you've referred to this as a post-factual election where facts don't matter. And you were just taking issue with something that Donald Trump said. And there were other things, the so-called fake news disinformation out there, stories. There was a crazy story towards the end of the campaign in which the NYPD was supposedly about to throw Hillary Clinton and her whole gang in jail because of stuff found on Anthony Weiner's computer that linked everybody to child sex trafficking. Just a bizarre story that, interestingly enough, General Flynn retweeted at one point. How much of a problem was this post-factual election, in your view?
I think it was a huge problem. And I think, look, Jake, I think there's a lot of things we need to examine coming out of this. You just named one of them. Congress has got to investigate what happened with Russia here. We cannot have foreign and foreign aggressors, I would argue, intervening in our elections. And we know that the Russians were promulgating fake news through Facebook and other outlets. But look, we also had, and this is with all due respect, you know, to Kellyanne and to her colleagues, this isn't personal. But, you know, Steve Bannon ran Breitbart News, which was notorious for peddling stories like this. And I'm not attacking him personally, but they peddled a lot of stories on that website that are just false. They're just not true. And that reinforced sexist, racist, anti-Semitic notions in people, you know, headlines that just make your that you know are shocking and insulting and shouldn't be part of our public discourse.
Kellyanne,
I think the biggest piece of fake news in this election was that Donald Trump couldn't win. So there's that, and that was peddled probably for weeks and months before the campaign, definitely in the closing days. If you look at major newspapers and major cable stations networks. Jake, it's unmistakable.
I never said that he couldn't win. I said it was a competitive race. Well, there was emotion.
I didn't say you didn't. Okay. No. I'm saying, but particularly print stories. I mean, we have colleagues whom we all respect, some of whom are in this room, that represent outlets. Literally, if you go back, because we have them, and you pull the whole front page.
There's a lot of Dewey defeats Truman's out there.
Unbelievable.
Absolutely.
But that's fake, because it's based on things that just aren't true. They have no path. They have no ground game. She's got more money. She has more personnel. She can't possibly lose. And then, of course, the growing narratives, which I'm not going to, the persistent chronic narratives, which I'm not going to repeat here, but they essentially boil down to Donald Trump takes the wings off of butterflies. And that, you know, America said, there's a difference between what may offend me and what absolutely affects me. And I, as a voter, are going to go that way. And I'm going to vote according to what absolutely affects me.
I want to move on to the vice presidential decisions. At what point was Bernie Sanders stricken from the list? And the reason I ask is because we know that he was on the list of 39 or so possible contenders. He obviously generated a great deal of enthusiasm. He obviously reached out to a lot of groups that you didn't find easy to reach out, millennials, white working class voters. He won the Michigan primary. He won the Wisconsin primary, two states you ultimately did not win. Why not put him on the ticket? What did Tim Kaine offer that Bernie Sanders didn't?
Yeah, it's a great question. And look, Bernie Sanders is a really important part of our campaign no matter what. We would not have had the successful convention that we did without Bernie Sanders' help. We would not have had as many people support us as did without Bernie Sanders' help. He was an enormous part of our presence on the ground in October in particular, and we're really grateful to him for that. You know, the decision, I think Kellyanne would agree with this, the decision about who should be your vice president should be a decision about who you think is ready to do the job and who you can see as a partner, you know, someone down the hall who you can call on to work with you. And that's how Hillary approached this, and I assume that's how Donald Trump approached this. As well, and he was on that list because he deserved to be on that list, and he was considered fully along with over 30 other people. But at the end of the day, she felt like Tim Kaine would represent her views and values if, you know, God forbid, he had to become president, that he had the background and preparation to do the job, but also that partnership and that chemistry was the right one.
Do you think that Bernie Sanders might have made it a tougher race?
Yes. And Bernie Sanders, I'd also like to publicly thank Bernie Sanders for his effect on our campaign, because he softened up Hillary Clinton. He won 22 states and 13 million voters, and that ain't nothing. That was significant.
And he worked hard to deliver them for Hillary Clinton.
Well, he did, but you know, I was at the same convention in Philadelphia, the Democratic convention, and the fact is, his supporters were still out there protesting her. He was in the hall being, you know, a dutiful Democratic convention soldier, but his supporters were not. And you saw on Election Day, if you read the polls, it's still many of them were upset by the way he was treated and the fact that the views that they took to the table were never really fully assimilated into the Clinton-Kaine campaign. I assumed her choice of Tim Kaine had something to do with Virginia, but it may have had something to do with not being overshadowed. I thought that he was not a particularly effective pick in the end or at the beginning, and certainly not the vice presidential debate, which was not even close. He interrupted the female moderator about 36 times. That was not a great moment. And look, I just want to tell you, somebody was involved in the vice presidential selection process, suggestions anyway. I had worked with Mike Pence for probably 10 years, and he had been in Congress for 12 years, 10 of which he sat on the Foreign Affairs Committee, very successful governor of Indiana. We always thought if we were going to bust that blue wall, it would definitely be with the help of a running mate who comes from that area and really allies himself with the concerns of the working class voters.
Well, let me ask you, because there were reports after Donald Trump picked Mike Pence that he had second thoughts and that he
Untrue.
Was trying to figure out whether or not he could go back on it and pick Governor Chris Christie. Not true?
Completely false.
Well, but they
Absolutely
ran on different
untrue.
Platforms. I mean, one of the things
Pence,
you saw
Pence
in
and Trump?
Well, one of the things you saw in that vice presidential debate was that he contradicted Trump repeatedly, particularly on foreign policy, where one of our core arguments on the campaign was that Donald Trump was an enormous risk to our foreign policy, and you know, we'll see how that pans out.
Let's turn to some pivotal moments in the home stretch, the Access Hollywood videotape. Who told Donald Trump about the tape? Who watched it with him? What was his reaction?
Oh, we were in debate prep, and one of the members of the team came in and took a few of us out and showed us. We didn't have the tape for a long time. We only had a transcript. And so, but anyway, you know the rest. Donald Trump decided he would like to put out a video apology, and he did that night. And 2 days later was the second debate in St. Louis, and he carried forward with that. I will tell you, if you look at the polling, that incident affected Donald Trump's numbers much more significantly than the Comey letter affected Hillary Clinton's numbers. That's just a fact. You can go back and look at the data, and there was not early voting really underway on October 7th as opposed to what had already been banked by October 28th. A lot of folks had voted already by the time the Comey letter came out, 3 weeks to the day.
Probably 80 to 90% of the electorate had not yet voted when the Comey
but
letter
when the
in
tape
in
came
fairness.
Out, Saturday Night Live had Hillary Clinton popping a bottle of champagne.
Yeah, that was ridiculous.
Was that your reaction? Did you think, oh my God, this is done, this is over?
Not at all. That was not, in fact, I remember the meeting I was in when that news came out was we were dealing with WikiLeaks. And that was something that our campaign, the stolen emails that the Russians were leaking out, we had to deal with that every day, and we stayed focused on that. I thought anybody who was popping champagne bottles was just wrong. And in fact, again, I remember we put out a video 2 weeks out from Election Day saying we can lose this race, and we got to rally, and we got to work hard.
Let me just ask you quickly about the WikiLeaks matter. Let's just remove from the conversation that that's why you won and they lost, okay? Are you at all concerned by the fact that intelligence agencies say that Russians were hacking into the email accounts and the email servers of the DNC and John Podesta, and that it may have had?
I just don't know it to be true.
Well, somebody hacks.
Yeah, but people have been going on TV too and saying that the Trump campaign knew this. The Trump campaign was.
No, I'm not saying any of that, but the intelligence agencies have testified
ridiculous.
To that fact. I mean,
it is a fact, Jake. 17
Admiral Mike Rogers, who
said this
President-elect Trump is
right.
interviewing for a potential job, has said it as well. I mean, they're clearly a foreign actor was doing it. Does it just? Assuming that it's true, okay?
I don't want to assume that it's true because I don't know it. And you're asking me a hypothetical, but you're the one who quoted from WikiLeaks. I didn't. So
17 national security agencies have said this is true. It's true.
I don't understand why you're reluctant to acknowledge that the intelligence agencies are saying it.
I'm not reluctant to acknowledge that. That's not the question you asked me. But I will tell you that we're not pro foreign government interference, if that's what you're asking. But I think all of this conversation is really skating around some very simple facts about the election. Fact number one, Hillary Clinton was a flawed candidate. That's okay. Every candidate is flawed in some way, but you have to work with that. And the idea that that wasn't true of Hillary Clinton before these emails were released or before Jim Comey released his letter on October 28th, folks, for a November 8th election. I mean, this woman's been running for president for many, many years. I would argue definitely for the last 8 years since she lost the first time to President Obama in the primaries. So it's incumbent upon her to connect with the American people, to give them a compelling vision and solutions for their economic woes, and to recognize that there are people in this country who are hurting, not to run around saying, we're gonna put the coal miners out of work. You know who else heard that? The coal miners, the steel workers, the pipe fitters, everyone who cares about those folks. And we ran the tables among those households.
And let me ask you about that, because it is a complaint we've heard in all the postmortems, an Ohio Democratic county chair saying that she conveyed to the Clinton campaign, the message here is that you care more about whether transgender individuals can use what bathrooms than whether or not these people can feed their families. And obviously, these are not groups that Democrats normally win in a Democratic presidential election, but they don't lose them in the same margins. Yeah. Those are some deep red counties that I saw coming up in Pennsylvania and Ohio. Did you focus too much on things Donald Trump said that offended people, and messages about inclusion at the expense of talking about how you can help people who are struggling feed their families?
And I will answer that. I gotta say this, it's weighing on my conscience. It is outrageous that a foreign aggressor got involved in our election. It has got to be investigated, and it should never, ever happen again in our history. I feel really strongly about that.
We'll make the final point on that
issue.
The
Russians did this.
But let me ask you about
I'm really glad you asked this question, because a lot of people brought it up, and it's a fair question. Look, we didn't win Michigan, we didn't win Wisconsin, we didn't win Ohio. We didn't win Pennsylvania. Thank you for reminding me.
We're from around the Philly. We're from around the Philly area.
I was obsessed with that.
We didn't win those states, and we did come up short. But the idea that Hillary Clinton didn't campaign on the economy is simply untrue. The very first video we released on our campaign when she announced her candidacy, those were families talking about their economic futures. Those were the issues that she was talking about. After our convention, she and Senator Kaine went to Western Pennsylvania, went to Eastern Ohio. They talked about jobs. That was a jobs tour. She gave multiple speeches criticizing Donald Trump for using illegally dumped Chinese steel to build his buildings. And in fact, if you look at the exit polls in Wisconsin, in Michigan, in Pennsylvania, among voters who said that the economy was their top issue, Hillary won those voters. So I don't think this was specifically about the economy. I think what was out there was an overwhelming gale force wind of change. And that's what was at play here. Absolutely, is there an economic dimension to that? Yes. But again, Hillary won those voters for whom that was their top issue.
But even then, there's a big difference between jobs, economy, and everyday affordability. And that is something Donald Trump did differently than past Republican presidential candidates. Mitt Romney famously talked about, and the convention in Tampa in 2012 certainly was, you didn't build that, entrepreneurs, job creators. Great. But about 7% of the country are job creators. About 7% or so are job seekers. If you just took the unemployment rate and those who are seeking jobs, the fact checkers don't have to go crazy. Just using it as an example to say that the vast majority of households in this country are neither job creators nor job seekers. They are job holders. And he was able to tap into the angst, not the anger, the angst and the frustration of job holders who are saying, we have 2 and 3 jobs in this household, and yet we're white-knuckled at the end of each month trying to pay the rent or the mortgage or the student loan voucher or the tuition. How did this happen? Why is the job no longer enough? It used to be the ticket to financial security and everyday affordability and indeed prosperity. And he tapped into that in a different way. Even the argument about Donald Trump and where he gets his steel is not an economic argument, it's an anti-Trump argument, which really formed the basis of their entire campaign. The day Mr. Trump offered me the job as campaign manager, Jake, I did say to him that, among other things, I said, you know, if this campaign is a referendum about you, she can win. If it's a referendum about her, we win. And that is something that I repeated publicly on TV. It wasn't a big secret. But the reason I said that was, She really needed to, she was trying, I think that when you're the non-incumbent, which she was, of course, but trying to follow a popular president who has some policies that are not popular with the American people, he's more popular than some of his signature policies. It's a difficult needle to thread, and I don't think they were that she was doing it well at different times, and it gave us an opening to get in there. And that's why we won some of those constituencies that President Obama won, some of those counties, certainly. But that's also why we were able to manage the deficits that Republicans usually have among some of those other constituencies or the issue set. Another quick example, I felt it was a big data point in the ABC News poll where it said which candidate cares about people like you or shares the concerns of people like you. Now that is a measure, the same question, where President Obama beat Governor Romney by like 82 to 10, famously, in 2012. That number in the ABC News poll about 2 weeks before the election was 46% Hillary Clinton, 43% Donald Trump. So you could say, well, she's winning it, but she's winning it by 3 points, not 70. And so I thought, wow, we're managing the normal deficits on empathy or on connectedness. And you see trends like that coupled with the momentum and enthusiasm that were ours, coupled with the fact that just not taking those days off that she took off. You look at the post-convention schedule in August.
She was fundraising and preparing for the debate.
I know,
she wasn't taking a day off.
And we were out there with people.
But you're out there campaigning. Robby, I want to ask you a question.
Actually, I just want to say one thing very quickly. I actually agree with Kellyanne's assessment about these families that are working hard and that they were the ones who felt left out in this political process. Donald Trump did better with those voters than we anticipated. Kudos to them for doing that. But I want to make one point. I am proud of Hillary Clinton because she ran in defense of the values that I believe and our voters believe made this country great. Tolerance, respect for other people, welcoming people from around the world, respecting other religions. Those are true American values. Hillary stood up for those every single day on the campaign. The Democratic Party can never give up on those values. And I don't like some people out there saying that the Democratic Party should abandon those values. We should be proud that Hillary Clinton, up until the last day of the campaign, one thing I disagree with Kelly on, she closed on a positive message with a vision about what kind of country we want to be, where we do respect one another, where we are stronger together. I'm very proud of that.
Well, let me ask you, Kellyanne, okay? I don't want to get into a whole lot. I understand that you were very offended when the Clinton campaign and when Hillary Clinton herself would use words like racist and sexist and xenophobe to describe Donald Trump. And I don't want to litigate what he is. But without question,
President-elect.
I don't mean that. I mean like whether or not those adjectives apply. He is president-elect.
I know what you meant.
President-elect Trump, without question, offended many minority groups and women, who are a majority, during this election, whether it is mocking a disabled reporter or seeming to question whether Judge Curiel could do his job because of his heritage. Did he ever in private express any regret about that? Because we heard from him on election night a desire to bring the country together.
Yes.
But that job will be tougher because of some of the things he said mostly before you came on board.
So I won't divulge private conversations, but I will tell you that shortly after I came on board, Mr. Trump was in North Carolina and gave a speech. And some people in the media refer to it as the regret speech because toward the middle or the end of it, he talked about, he expressed regret. That was the word he used. He expressed regret for having offended anyone. He said, particularly with my words. And that's a leader, you know, showing humility and inclusiveness and regret, to use his word. But he also, you know, he also was elected because of his strength and his consistency and people believing that he, you know, was out there vigorously every day going and seeing people, looking them in the eye where they live. We got a lot of good local media coverage that I think maybe a lot of folks wouldn't be aware of just because he and Governor Pence showed up in places. But I want to say this to you also. If you're talking about just the numbers alone, Donald Trump did better among Hispanics and African Americans than did Mitt Romney, John McCain, for example, the last two Republican presidential nominees, Jake. And he did much better among women than almost everybody, certainly everybody publicly predicted. I mean, you've got the first female presidential candidate. She's on the cusp of being the first female president. where are all these women? Where were the marches of women saying we must have the first female? I didn't see them on Fifth Avenue. I didn't see them in Washington, D.C.
They were volunteering for the campaign?
Well, they didn't come out and vote for her, though. The margin between President Obama and Mitt Romney, for example, among women, is really the same as between Secretary Clinton, a woman, and Donald Trump, who was being attacked by everybody as being against them. Also, I just want to say this, women and men, but it turned out that veracity, honesty, trustworthiness, not being an insider, those also were presidential qualifications. And everybody took their eye off the ball. Mm-hmm. You can't have 70% of the country saying, I want to take the country in a new and different direction, and try to peddle someone who represents everything about the system and elitism that they don't like.
The Boston Globe, speaking of local media coverage, the Boston Globe recently ran an op-ed by a woman named Diane Hessen. She was hired by your campaign to study undecided voters in battleground states, to talk to them every week and find out what they were thinking. She wrote that there was one moment more than any other where she saw undecided voters shift to Donald Trump. It was not the Comey letter. It was when Hillary Clinton referred to the basket of deplorables. She made that comment on September 9th. Did you realize at that time that comment that she made was as potentially damaging as this one study by somebody who worked for your campaign says it was?
I first of all, Hillary apologized right away after that and said that she misspoke and that she regretted the comment. That's something that Donald Trump wouldn't do.
She didn't say that. She said she regretted putting a number on it.
She regretted her choice of words. But Donald Trump never apologized to Keyser Conway.
I'm talking about Donald Hillary Trump. Clinton right now.
Sure, but
that's what they do.
But
you both do it.
Yes, but we won.
True.
No, but I think, look, you're talking about one instance where Hillary Clinton said one thing. She immediately explained that she regretted.
So you don't think it had an effect?
I think she regretted getting caught. Let's be honest here.
I think it definitely could have alienated some voters, and that's why she got out there right away. Look, here's the other thing I will say, though. I was proud the day after the election that Hillary Clinton said in her speech that Donald Trump is the president-elect and that he deserves the benefit of the doubt and the chance to lead, and we all need to give him that. I'm very critical of some of the choices he's already made, of the kind of people he's appointing, but those are his choices to make. I do hope he will listen to that popular vote, to the voices out there who did object to a lot of the things he said. He does have the opportunity to bring the country together, and I certainly hope that he'll do that.
One last question for you, Robby, because this I don't think has been covered at all, which is the night of the election, John Podesta came out and spoke to your supporters saying that Hillary Clinton was not going to have any comments that evening. A lot of people were surprised that there was not going to be any seeming closure that evening, given the fact that it was apparent that Donald Trump had won. We know now that President Obama called Secretary Clinton and said, you need to concede. She did call Donald Trump and she did concede. The next morning, she was going to give her concession speech. It took a couple hours before she got to the stage and gave the speech, a much celebrated speech, praised by everyone. What was going on behind the scenes?
Well, little fact-checking there.
Okay, you know,
first
please.
Of all, well, we set the time for that speech the night before. We wanted to give our people time to show up and be there and get through security and so on. So it's not as if that speech was delayed. We set that time at maybe 4 in the morning.
The impression that a lot of us had was, boy, she's having a tough time with this. Certainly understandably
no.
So. No?
No. And in fact, some of these reports are, you know, like Kellyanne, I'm not going to get into private conversations that were had. She made the decision to call Donald Trump.
She didn't do that because President Obama told her.
She made that decision on her own before she spoke to the president. And she made it because she believed, and she had said during the campaign that it is important to our democracy that whoever wins, that their opponent concede the election and be supportive of them becoming president-elect. And so she acted in good faith with that.
And that is true. We had arranged ahead of time.
We did.
How we would speak with each other that night.
You had talked before the election.
We had emailed and agreed. I see an email from Robby Mook, and I think it's a fundraising appeal. And then I click on, I'm like, it's an email from Robby. I'm so excited.
So you two had actually negotiated.
Yes, and I'm sure that we had a little plan, and we actually
executed on that plan.
Yes, I looked down at my phone, and it said Uma Abedin. I said, oh, my God. And I handed it to Donald Trump. And he's absolutely right. Secretary Clinton was gracious, but she congratulated Donald Trump, and she also conceded to him. And that's an important point to make here, because Now you have people participating in a recount. And as the person who was asked 3,462 times on television, Jake, will he respect the election results? Will his supporters move on?
I only asked you twice.
Will his supporters move on? I'd like to pose the question to her supporters. I mean, are you going to accept the election results? Because hashtag, he's your president too. And I think the right questions were being asked about the wrong candidate and the supporters. But I am glad Robby just mentioned that. Because the combination of Secretary Clinton congratulating, conceding, and then telling the American people the next day, let's have the peaceful, I'm paraphrasing her now, but let's have the peaceful transfer of democracy, let's respect the process and the president-elect. And then the very next day after that, President Obama saying the same thing in meeting with Donald Trump in the Oval Office, First Lady Michelle Obama and Mrs. Melania Trump doing the same. I think people need to take the cues from the leaders of the Democratic Party, frankly, President Obama and Secretary Clinton.
We're going to take some questions from the audience, but before we do, I'm going to thank you, and we're going to do the applause thing, and then we're going to change tape. So, Robby Mook, Kellyanne Conway, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it. We're back. Our first question is from Malia Henderson. She is a student at Harvard College. She has a question for Kellyanne Conway.
Hi, I just wanted to start off by thanking you both for coming out. It's really been a pleasure to hear you speak. My name is Malia Henderson, as you mentioned, and I'm a sophomore here at the college studying computer science. And I have a question for Kellyanne. As a woman, how do you respond to criticism that President-elect Donald Trump is misogynist? And how did you personally reconcile his past comments about sexual assault?
I got that same question yesterday as a plant in Washington, D.C., so I'm glad this is your original question. So I know he's not a misogynist. This is a man who has employed and elevated women through the ranks, now in his cabinet, certainly in his campaign, first Republican to do so, and successfully, and certainly in his corporation for a number of decades. I also know that his policies are pro-woman. He's creating 25 million jobs over the next 10 years and investing in all types of energy sources, wanting to make healthcare more affordable, accessible, increase the choices, the quality, the access, lower the cost for all Americans. Women are the chief healthcare officers of their households. We control roughly two out of every three healthcare dollars spent in this country. And his willingness to talk about alternatives to conventional education through choice and charters, repealing Common Core. We heard a lot from America's women on that. Women also are very concerned about national security. So I think as a candidate and as a president-elect, and indeed as a president, Malia, you will find a man who, as he said on election night or in the wee hours of November 9th, that Wednesday anyway, that he will be the president of all Americans. I think people were very quick to cherry pick a comment or an alleged incident here and there. That's all been vetted very heavily. If you look at the objective media content analysis of network coverage, so much more time was spent on the alleged accusers and the accusations against Donald Trump than the emails, by the way, or the FBI investigations, just objective content analysis. So the country saw this, the country heard this, and they made a decision that they wanted to elect Donald Trump as their president based, I think, on the vision and values. And it's not for me as a woman, it's just me as an American, as a voter, as somebody who cares, and frankly, as a mother of four, which includes three daughters, and they're all young, they're all school age. And so reconciling it, I just wanna say too, as a woman, I'm all for a female president, and I'm glad I've helped preserve the right for any women here to become the first female president, so you're welcome. but I also can't countenance lying, and I can't countenance dishonesty and untruthfulness and the fact that things were done and things were said and questions went unanswered, that I think it's incredibly wonderful that Hillary Clinton lives in a country and in a great democracy where she can ascend all the way to be the nominee of her party for president and come very close to being elected president of the United States. I'm glad to live in that country. I'm also glad to live in a country where America's men and women saw through a lot of the vicious negative attacks that were coming from all corners and vote based on substantive issues, and I'm also very happy to live in a country where women in the future will have an opportunity to run for president, and that women in this country this year said, you know, she shares my gender, but they also asked their question, does she share my values, my vision, does she understand my everyday concerns, do we have much in common, where's the connective tissue?
I think because Hillary ran, it's going to be easier for women to become president. And
well, these are young women. Let's hope it doesn't take 15 or 20 years before we get the first woman president. Ignacio Arbona from Harvard, who has a question for Robby.
Hi, I'm Ignacio. I'm a junior at the college. I study economics. And my question is about reports that former President Bill Clinton pushed Hillary in the campaign to have a stronger economic message and warned about the loss of his former base, white working class voters. Are these reports true? And if so, do you think that the Democratic Party is moving away from these, this core group of voters?
Well, I think, let me first of all say, President Clinton is one of the most brilliant communicators, one of the smartest people I have ever worked with in my entire life. And he was an integral part of our campaign team. And I was in meetings with him. We spent a lot of time on the phone. He was a tremendous mentor to me and a strategist on our campaign. And as I said earlier, Hillary spent a lot of time in Western Pennsylvania and Eastern Ohio campaigning on the economy. In fact, President Clinton was with her after the convention when they did their economic tour together. So he was an integral part of imagining that tour and imagining a lot of the campaigning we did, and he pushed us on that. And he did have great appeal. As you mentioned, when he ran both times for president, and I think he'll be an important part of our party bringing some of those voters back in the future.
Is it true that he's upset, that he's mad about the campaign?
I think he's really upset about that letter from James Comey. And I think he's really proud of the campaign that Hillary ran.
Let's go to Declan Garvey from Harvard, who has a question for Kellyanne.
Yeah, thank you so much. My name's Declan. I'm a senior at the college and president of the Republicans here at Harvard. My question has to do with President-elect Trump's communication strategy. Specifically, if he's going to continue using his Twitter account. I know it breeds a lot of authenticity, but he's also been known to tweet out falsehoods and other liabilities. So is that something that he plans to do after inaugurated?
Does he plan to use his Twitter account? Is that the question? I heard
the rest of it. In the same manner that he does currently.
So that's going to be up to him, the Secret Service, and others who have to help decide those issues. I will tell you that the president-elect looks at his social media accounts, a combined 25 million or probably more at this point, users on Twitter and Facebook as a very good platform through which to convey his messages. I can tell you firsthand that there are posts that he makes that otherwise would not be heard or seen by those 25 million people but for him posting this. So for example, we'll link to an article or we'll issue an alert that there's a live event coming up in a place near you. He's on his Thank You America tour now. And he's in Cincinnati tonight, and he'll be in Des Moines, and he'll be in other places. But the fact is that that was a great tool through which to also notice these events to people. It's also, I think, in many ways, you know, he was more ready for a 21st century campaign than I think people realized. He has many ways of communicating, though. The press is in the Trump Tower lobby every day, asking questions, seeing what's going on. He obviously will staff up the way all the presidents do with a press secretary and a communications director and others who speak on his behalf and those on the outside who speak on his behalf. But you know, he's a unique person who's been following his instincts and his judgment from the beginning, and it served him so well, and his brilliance, frankly. The man is, I know for a fact that President Clinton is brilliant. Donald Trump is brilliant. He's a successful businessman. His instincts are unparalleled. And he actually, you know, for someone who took issues that were 1, 2, 3%, like trade and immigration, and to bring them to the fore and to stick with them all the way through the general election is sort of an answer to the same question, which is he's going to continue to use his instinct. The question about what a president can do and can't do will be answered by people, not named me.
I think one of the points that I think we'd all be interested in hearing is in the last week, he tweeted that there were millions of fraudulent votes. There's no evidence that there were millions of fraudulent votes. I don't doubt that there were some fraudulent votes. There always are. But the idea that the only reason Hillary Clinton won the popular vote is because of millions of fraudulent votes is not true. And then when CNN reported on that, he started retweeting people criticizing Jeff Zeleny, our reporter, including a 16-year-old boy. And I think the question arises, in a room full of people who want President-elect Trump to succeed, who want him to realize a vision where there are more jobs coming into this country, where you do achieve so much of what you want to achieve, is that really presidential behavior?
Well, he's the president-elect, so that's presidential behavior, yes.
So the things that Bill Clinton did in the Oval Office that you criticized, those were presidential?
Are you actually comparing what Bill Clinton did in the Oval Office
with a Twitter feed? You're saying if the president does it, it's presidential.
Should we review for those who weren't born then what President Clinton did in the Oval Office?
I'm saying just because a president does something doesn't make it presidential.
Yes, I wasn't saying otherwise. But the fact is, this man is now president of the United States. And he's tackling very big issues, the ones that he campaigned on and the ones that he will execute through his first 100-day plan. I know him very well. I'm a trusted advisor. He is committed to making good on the promises and frankly, the plans. And he's going to be focused on that, not on everybody trying to nitpick every single thing he does. Because I think, Jake, you know, respectfully, there are people who still think we're in the campaign, we're in the permanent campaign. I mean, everybody wants to go back in a time machine and do things differently so that this result that nobody saw coming won't come somehow. And that's too bad, and it's also not going to happen. So we need to move on and support the president and the initiatives that he's going to make. I don't like a lot of things that people in leadership do, but they're there. And that should be respected. I mean, I was raised to respect the office of the president and its current occupant, no matter who he or she is and their party. And it'd be nice to see that. And it'd be nice to see that even in the line of questioning that Team Trump is getting from many people these days. He's talking a lot about, I mean, look what happened today. We're not talking about what happened today. He and Governor Pence, Vice President-elect Pence, were in Indiana with Carrier, with United Technologies, announcing that 1,000 plus jobs are going to stay in this country, stay in Indiana and not go to Mexico is exactly what he campaigned on. And he's able to work with a company in this country to make that happen. There are 1,000 workers as we speak now whose lives look measurably, markedly better because their jobs will stay here. So we can choose to talk about that, which is exactly what Americans want to hear about and know about and see happen, or we can choose to talk about the other things. I'm going to choose to talk about that.
Jake, I just hope moving forward from this campaign, you know, Kellyanne is right. The campaign's over. It's time to move on. I just hope the truth doesn't get lost or sacrificed. We can have legitimate disagreements over what's true, you know, what's good and what's the right direction. And we need to disagree over those things. That's what a democracy is about. We cannot lose the truth. And it's very scary to me the way that false information is not just put out there sort of by mistake, it's being peddled deliberately for the purpose of deceiving people. And the president-elect, the vice president-elect, Hillary Clinton, Bill Clinton, we all have to work together to restore truth and facts in our political process, otherwise we can't govern.
Yasmeen Raji from the Harvard Kennedy School has a question for you, Robby.
Thank you so much both for being here tonight. My name is Yasmeen Raji. I'm a second year master's in public policy student at the Kennedy School. And Robby, I spent a lot of my weekends up in New Hampshire knocking on doors for Secretary Clinton.
Thank you.
As did a lot of folks here. We're excited to make that one state turn blue. But wanted to ask you a question about whether the Clinton campaign was too confident or in some might say arrogant throughout this election cycle in a way that might have led to some complacency among voters.
Look, I'm glad you asked that question. I want to return to something I said before, which is if anybody takes away anything from this campaign, is that every vote is precious and everybody's participation matters, and our choices have impact. You know, we know for a fact that some young people in particular were voting for third party candidates. And if those votes had gone a different way, the election could have turned out in a different way. It's their choice where to put their vote. So I'm not criticizing or blaming them. But those choices do matter, and we've seen in, you know, in the 2000 election, for example, that the same thing happened. Look, I'm incredibly proud of the staff team on our campaign who worked their hearts out, and Hillary Clinton who worked her heart out. I was very frustrated at times when, and I think Kellyanne and I would agree on this, when some news outlets would say the election was a foregone conclusion, or when, you know, this habit that I think some news organizations got into of assigning a percentage likelihood to win and so on. I think we have to reevaluate that system and set the system up to inform voters and to make the contest not like a sport, but a real decision that people have to make that's going to have an impact on their future. So again, I think the way we all have a civic obligation to protect the truth, I think we have a civic obligation to step back over the next 4 years, think about the right way to set up this process so that the next time people make a choice, it is taken seriously, and everybody casts that vote, which is so precious, as wisely as possible.
But do you think that the Clinton campaign bears any of the responsibility for that impression that this was a foregone conclusion? I know that you hold people in the media accountable. Do you also think they are responsible?
Well, I hold anybody accountable. I mean, we all, anybody who's involved in this at this level, Jake, has a responsibility. Talk about the truth. To tell the truth or to tell when you don't know the truth. I mean, there's something in this political media access, AXIS, where somebody's afraid to say, I don't know, or we don't know that yet. And that happens with undecided voters, too. I look at these polls and it's like 95% are accounted for, and I'm thinking that's not true 2 months before the election. Like 5% of the Trump and Clinton families may be undecided, let alone the rest of us. So why are we pushing people? And that's just a joke, everybody calm.
want to open up the microphone.
But no, I wanted to say this though.
Yeah.
I do think there's some responsibility because when the polls were tight, I remember Robby was on TV saying, and he's right, we've always known this was going to be a close race. I think we were like taking the lead at some point in August or September. We always knew this was going to be a close election. We're prepared for a close election. We're ready for that. And then when they were opening up the leads in the public media polling, things were said like, election day will be over, the election will be over before election day because of the early vote. That's just empirically false because it's statistically impossible. What are you going to do with states where 90% of the vote comes in on election day, like Pennsylvania or New Hampshire or Michigan? So that's just not true, and it shouldn't have been said. But it was said in a press call.
It was said about specific states.
It was said in the press call, and people wrote it like it was the truth without fact-checking or verifying it. So yes, but I also think in this sort of us versus them environment, and Donald Trump is the original, he's the voice for the forgotten man, forgotten woman. He was trying to give voice and visibility to the people who feel left behind, economically and otherwise. I think being told who was going to win and to sit down and shut up and not bother and you're a loser and you're deplorable and you're, it helped us in the end because people were really fired up. This is the most equalizing commodity that you own is your vote. It's equalized, we all have one vote. And I think that helped us with turnout.
Is there, if somebody wants to go up, you can, first person, please give us, hold on one second. When you give us your name and where you're from, and if we could keep this as polite as it's been, that would be great.
Great. Hi, my name is Ariana Grand. I'm an MPP2 student from the Kennedy School. Kellyanne, this question is for you. In President Trump's acceptance speech, he talked about wanting to heal the country. However, Steve Bannon is now going to be serving as an advisor in the campaign. And I'm wondering how you can reckon somebody who is anti-Semitic and has certain views with healing the country. Can you explain that?
Because he's not anti-Semitic. I know him. And he's not anti-Semitic. And this idea that, again, people are going to continue with the campaign now trying to attack personnel as a way to attack Donald Trump is wrong, and it's unfortunate. Steve Bannon is a Harvard Business School graduate. He's Goldman Sachs vice president. He is a former naval officer who served his country. I mean, others can smirk, but these are the facts. They may be inconvenient to the conclusion that you'd like to put forward. Did you say to keep it polite? Well, but anyhow, I know him, I've worked with him. I've never heard anything, let alone developed a strategy around the isms and the ists that you and many others are saying. So I'm just going to leave it there. I know who he is. Donald Trump knows who he is. We know who he's been to the, she's not even listening to the answer. We know he's been to the campaign, and he's going to serve the President Trump at a very high level. And I think the fruits of that labor will be obvious to everyone because he's a brilliant tactician who's been unfairly maligned.
It's great to have you both here. My name is Dustin Chang. I'm a sophomore here at Harvard College studying government. President-elect Trump spoke to a large section of America that felt economically lost. After an election result that has left many other Americans feeling hopeless, lost, or threatened in their own country, Robby, what do you see as the path forward for and the role of the Democratic Party?
Well, look, the Democratic Party, and the reason I'm a Democrat, is that it has always fought, first of all, for working people. And so we do need to make the case. We have disagreements with Trump. I think his economic policies are going to overwhelmingly help the wealthiest people in this country, not working people. That's a disagreement. That's a policy issue. But I think our party also has a rich history of fighting for the dignity and civil rights of all people. And so I think we need to stick to those values and stick to those beliefs. And if we do, we will be successful. I think the worst thing that we can do as a party or for anybody who, you know, I know people here volunteered their time on both sides of this campaign. And what I'd say to everybody is you've got to stay active. You know, that's how this works. And this system belongs to each one of us equally, and we each have our own voice. And so we've got to keep fighting. And we all wish President-elect Trump the best, and we hope that he will succeed, because if he is successful, our country is successful. But that doesn't mean that we won't speak out. And when he is doing something that we don't agree with or don't believe in, we're going to resist that. And all of us have an obligation to do that. At all times. And again, I hope our party sticks to what it's always done, and it's fighting for everyday people and fighting to make our country more inclusive and create more opportunities.
I have to interject, though. The Democratic Party missed a huge opportunity to do exactly that yesterday by giving Nancy Pelosi her leadership position back. They've lost 60 seats on her watch. She was running against Tim Ryan, who represents exactly the kind of district that Robby is describing here. My friend Robby is describing here about, you know, the voiceless or those left behind economically, as some of you were saying. He represents Youngstown, Mahoning County, a county that went from 62-36 Democratic to 49-46 Democratic this time. And lost a great opportunity to elevate Tim Ryan, who was trying to give voice and visibility to these same folks who just went for Donald Trump and should have gone for Hillary Clinton. And now they have, you know, a wealthy San Francisco liberal representing the party as a way to reach out and heal the party and move it forward. So I was relieved when I saw that. I was so worried Tim Ryan would actually get the nod, and that the Democrats had learned anything from this election. You lost 60 congressional seats, over a dozen senators, over a dozen governorships, 1,000 plus state legislative seats since President Obama and Nancy Pelosi were elected. And I mean, if that's not a wake up call, and now the presidency, I don't know what is. So this all sounds great, but it hit reality yesterday. And I read somewhere that you even mentioned, Jake, I don't want to mischaracterize the Democrats now have, you know, a liberal from New York
liberal,
and a liberal from San Francisco running their party.
Liberal San Francisco.
That's, I said it. Yeah.
It's true.
Hi, my name is Katie Dolan. I'm a junior at the college. Ms. Conway, many Americans in the week since the election have expressed anything from apprehension to even fear about some of the rhetoric that was, you know, discussed in the election cycle. What can you say to assuage some of the apprehension on behalf of minority groups or others that President-elect Trump directly denigrated in his campaign?
Sounds like the last question, but I'll answer it. So he said on the night he was victorious that he would be the president for all Americans. Those were his words. I was there when he was writing them. He'll be the president to all Americans, not just those who voted for him, and he means it, and he will do that. The other thing I would say is there are millions of Americans who agree with you, but for a different reason. They were very fearful and apprehensive to think that we were going to get a president who thinks half the country is deplorable and, even more importantly, irredeemable. And that was offensive to many people in this country. And it did hurt her, not just among the undecideds, but among people who felt she was taking aim right at them, that maybe they don't wear the same kind of clothes or eat in the same type of restaurants or make the same type of money, or famously, as she has said, not driven themselves in a car in 20 years now and counting. And so there was a lot of fear and apprehension to go around, and that came right to the ballot box. But more than fear and apprehension, there was angst by many people. And I would just say to those individuals, at least do what Robby Mook and Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama have now said that they are going to do, which is wish the president-elect the best, give him his time to form a government, speak in opposition as you'd like to, because this is America after all, but at least get to that stage where you give him a chance to enact policies that are meant to be good for all Americans.
I just have to say, and Kellyanne's going to disagree with me on this, I think you cannot compare, in my mind, the way Donald Trump alienated certain citizens in our country. And one remark that Hillary Clinton made, which she quickly corrected, they're completely different. And
hello, my name is Joseph Cho. I'm a senior here at Harvard. I'm also the president of the Harvard Political Review. My question is for Ms. Conway. Donald Trump has said some interesting things throughout the election. He said he wants to rip up mutual defense treaties with allies like South Korea. He said he wants to ban Muslims from entering the country. He's boasted about sexually assaulting women. When you hear these things, how do you decide whether or not to defend them and when to break away? And related to that, what has been the most difficult thing that you've defended during this election?
Did he say defended?
The most difficult thing you've defended.
Most difficult thing I've defended is spending less time with my four children. So Donald Trump never asks me to defend anything. And that's the beauty of working for him. He trusts completely that I will explain what he said or what he meant, that I know enough about his policies and about him and his character to be able to talk about that publicly. Even that tape that everybody wants to keep talking about, everybody here and elsewhere anyway, that he never asked anybody to defend that. He came on TV and said he was sorry for it and he wasn't going to defend it. His wife said something similar. His running mate said something similar. So I also just want to go back to a remark I made earlier because it's incredibly important in my view to really explain the election. It's people make it, they make a choice between what may, and may, by the way, what may offend them and what absolutely positively does affect them, or what temporarily bothers them and what permanently affects them. And that is really an untold story from this election cycle, I think, particularly in the last 4 months. But you know, you've asked a variation on the of the same question respectfully, and it was asked here as well, so I'll stand by the earlier remarks.
We have time for two more questions.
Hi, my name is Rosie Greenberg, and I'm a first-year master's student here at the Kennedy School. Since the election, the Southern Poverty Law Center has documented over 1,000 hate incidents from people who around the country against people of color, women, Muslims, and members of the LGBT community and persons with disabilities. And though Donald Trump has disavowed the alt-right, I wonder what concrete steps he will take in the next few weeks to protect these people from verbal and physical assaults and attacks from his supporters.
Well, first, they're an anti-Trump group. But secondly, there are hateful people in
this
country.
The Southern Poverty Law Center is an
anti-Trump. Yes. There are, but apart
from
that,
there are civil rights advocacy organization there.
Who also is very anti-Trump.
They have an incredible track record.
But let me just say that there's hate
in
this country. There's hate in this country based on many different things. Well, look them up, guys. Don't just go by.
They have a great track record of defending civil rights.
Of being anti-Trump.
Incredible history.
I didn't say they didn't.
We should honor.
But let me just say, she's asking me a question about Trump, so I'll answer it. There's hate in this country. There are people who say and do outrageous, if not hateful criminal things. That certainly preceded this year's election, that will follow this year's election, that will follow all of us on this earth, unfortunately. And Donald Trump has disavowed all these people who have tried to associate themselves with him, who he's never met. And I think you just conflated something that would be unfair for me to just let go as a legitimate question. You talked about documenting hate incidents, and then you asked what he would do about the alt-right. So you're trying to conflate something that you're not proving, so I'm not going to actually answer that. I'll just go back to what Donald Trump said, which is that he condemns hate, he condemns violence, he's not connected with these people. He said at the, where was it? He said right after he was elected somewhere, in the 60 Minutes interview, I'm telling them right now to cut it out, whoever the they is. And to associate him with the most hateful elements of the nation and presume that he either is responsible for them or with, you know, a statement is going to be able to do away with the hate that's existed and for decades, frankly, I think is naive and unfair. So I think we all need to work together. I'm yet to hear that. We all need to work together to make sure that we do our level best as people to eradicate the hate and to understand each other a little bit more. But the questions tonight don't really sound that way to me, that some people are well on their way to wanting to do their part to try to make that happen.
I've just got to say, and Kellyanne's going to disagree with us, fine. As a future constituent of Donald Trump, he has got to speak out more loudly and more clearly against
The New York Times, the Ku Klux Klan
endorsed him. He should have spoken out. These are hate groups.
Did he ask for their endorsement, Robby? Did he accept their endorsement? Has he met them? Does he know? No, be fair. Endorsed him. Did he ask them to?
There are young people in this country who are coming of age. They are forming their opinions. The president is a role model. The Ku Klux Klan is unacceptable.
No,
it's wrong.
No kidding.
And he needs to say that.
And he has said it many times, and you know he has, including to the New York Times last week. He didn't ask for their endorsement. He didn't accept their endorsement. He doesn't pal around with them. He doesn't know them. And you know it.
Go to the last question.
Thank you so much for coming. My name is Andy Vo. I'm a second-year master's student at Harvard Kennedy School. I'm also the son of two Vietnamese refugees. It's well established that the vetting process for Syrian refugees is quite secure, going through the FBI, DOD, State Department, and Homeland Security. It's also well established that America takes in immigrants seeking refuge, freedom, and religious liberty. I have a question for Ms. Conway. How do you reconcile these facts and these American values with Donald Trump's rejection of refugees?
Well, I disagree with your first premise. I think that's your take on how strong our vetting system is in this country. I would point you to the comments that ISIS made that they may come through the Syrian refugee program. I would also point you to the fact that many governors immediately stood up and said, hold on, we need a stricter vetting system before we allow this to happen. At this particular time, with this particular population, I don't think it's gone very well necessarily in Germany, for example. I think Angela Merkel's taken some real heat for the way she has approached this issue there. I know that one of the most potent positions against Hillary Clinton, most potent arguments against Hillary Clinton was her position that would have basically led to a massive increase of several hundred percent over the number of Syrian refugees that would be allowed into the country if she had been elected president. I'm sure they surveyed that, we certainly did. And it was said probably in two, if not three, of the debates and elsewhere. So I disagree with the premise that you're saying this government agency, that government agency, this government agency has said our vetting is perfect. It's not, and not everyone agrees with that, and the president-elect doesn't agree with that, but it's certainly something that he will look at. This country has a rich tradition of accepting refugees who are escaping religious or political persecution. And that is not what we're talking about exclusively with the issue that you're raising and the vetting that you're insisting is perfect. It's not. And I think that you want to go and look at exactly what Donald Trump has said about this issue, but also what he has said about his 10-point plan and then his extreme vetting plan. It affects the countries where we simply don't have a good vetting program in place, and it affects countries that have a tradition of training and harboring and indeed exporting radical terrorists. And anybody who thinks that's not true or doesn't happen in this country hasn't been paying attention or should go talk to the families who have victims of that terrorism. The president-elect disagrees with President Obama that ISIS is in retreat and is a JV team. He absolutely disagrees with Secretary Clinton's characterization of ISIS at her convention in Philadelphia in July, where they are our, quote, determined enemies. We are not playing a lacrosse match against them. They are not our determined enemies. They're bloodletting savage murderers, and we've seen that happen just in the last year or so, here and abroad.
Thank you for your question. I appreciate it. That's all the time we have. I do want to say one thing. First of all, what these two people have been through the last year and a half, 2 years, is really, really tough. It's really, really difficult.
Taking obnoxious questions from people like me every day makes it even worse. And I really just want to give them both a round of applause for all their hard work.
Thank you.
For their candidates.
Thank you.